are heard by you, and pray that these hats and these shawls might convey your power and your love and your mercy and your healing touch to all those who receive them. We pray, God, that they bring comfort and warmth and care, that those who wrap themselves in these are so aware of your presence in their lives and your working in their lives and in their situation. And we pray, God, that you would take these not to people who necessarily already know about your love and already know about your presence with them, but those who are questioning that, those who wonder how you can be with them and how you can love them. We pray that you will send these out to those who find themselves in the dark and in need of light, those who are cold and in need of your warmth. These things we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Now, do we have birthdays? We have some birthdays, I think, this week. I don't have the list in front of me. So why don't we... Oh, Tom!
Who?
Just Tom.
Tom!
Just Tom.
What he missed last week, right?
Yep.
Yeah?
That's right.
Oh! You were busy up here?
Come on up.
Happy birthday to Jesus, be true. May God's richest blessings abide upon you.
Thank you. Astonished The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Please be seated. At this time, I'd like to invite all the young people forward. About today doesn't get any less confusing the older you get. It just doesn't. But I thought that maybe I would start talking to you guys about it. How many of you know how butterflies become butterflies? Okay, so some of the older ones, do you guys know how butterflies start out? Not yet? What would you tell me if I said butterflies are really just grown-up caterpillars? They're looking at me like, I don't get it. So caterpillars, when they get to a certain age and they get strong to a certain point, they sleep in a special sleeping bag that they call a cocoon for I don't remember how long. I was in school for a long time and I learned that at some point. Is there a biology teacher out there? Maybe a second grade teacher out there? Anyway, they sleep in a cocoon for like a week or two. And after a while, while they're in the cocoon, they start transforming into something else. Do you know what they start growing? What do they start growing? What's different? They start growing wings. And what else do they get rid of? What do they get rid of? Yeah, they get rid of their little legs. And they get rid of their fur, right? Because caterpillars are usually kind of furry. Yeah, they've got the legs. Well, so they grow their wings, and part of what helps them break out of the cocoon is how big and strong their wings get, right? So that's what I mean by butterflies and grown-up caterpillars. So here's my question. Do you think that the caterpillar got a second chance at life? It's like the caterpillar had a second birthday, isn't it? Because they had the birthday when they became a caterpillar, and then, well, when's their other birthday? They turn into a butterfly. That's right. So we as Christians believe that we have two birthdays too. Our spiritual birthday. What do you think that one is? That's right. The day you get baptized. And your birthday, right? The day we're used to. So here's my question. How many of you get to celebrate two birthdays at your house? Hey, I was going to say, you know what, I'm going to start lobbying for a second birthday. My second birthday is September 5th. So I think that we need to start lobbying for second birthdays. Because that's the day lots of things happen to you. It's not only that we believe that it's a spiritual birthday, it's a day that we become part of God's family. And it's a day that God gives us a completely fresh start, because no matter what we've done wrong, or what we think we're about to do wrong, or what we're going to do wrong in about 14 years, God promises us that we will always be part of his family, and that he's going to love us and forgive us. Right? Amen. So it's like we get a second chance, starting the day of our baptism, and going every single day because of the promises God makes to us on that second birthday. Is that confusing? Hey! I made it more understandable. That's good. Because it's totally confusing to me. But we'll learn together. together. We'll win some more as we get older, yeah? All right, let's pray. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
We thank you.
We thank you.
That you give us two birthdays.
That you give us two birthdays.
And that you make sure.
And that you make sure.
That we know.
And that we know.
That we are part of your family.
That we are part of your family.
And loved by you.
And loved by you.
Forever.
Forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, guys. Junior high and high school get to stay right here today. Not right here. Lori can sit right here. You got a better view.
Up to age 12, if you want to come back for a Sunday school story, come on back. It's going to be lots of fun.
Come on, kid. Otherwise, you're going to have to confuse you more about second birthdays. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord Jesus Christ, the God of second chances. Amen.
Amen.
When I was on internship, I had a member of our congregation who, she was brilliant. That's all there is to say about it. She was brilliant, and she was some sort of very fancy engineer by trade, but she had decided that she was going to homeschool her kids and spend time with her family, because she had six kids. And so she was always thinking, though. She was always thinking about the Bible and God and how it did work or how it didn't work and how she experienced it, but how she was told it was supposed to be, right? It never stopped. It was a constant thing for her. Some of you can, like, ask the question and go, one of these days I'll ask Pastor Steph. And then you forget about it. Oh, no. It was like this running tally in her head. And so she would come up to me often enough with these big questions, or she would write these big, long emails with these big questions often enough that we started having just a weekly get-together for a cup of coffee. It was her time to be away from the house. It was my time to try to kind of give her a frame for all of her big questions. I used to call that time, actually, I had a folder for her, and I called it Nicodemus by Day. She didn't sneak out of the house at night. She came to me in the middle of the day to just get away for about an hour and a half. She asked me these big questions that are, you know, fundamental to Christianity and Christian faith, right? That when you're still a seminarian and you're not a pastor, you think that if you don't give an answer to it, somehow this person's faith is going to totally crumble and fall apart, and you're never going to see them in church again. But after you've been a pastor for a little while, you learn, actually, you can do more harm than good that way. So anyway, the reason I call her Nicodemus by Day is because she was smart, like the Pharisee Nicodemus, who came to Jesus asking, how is it possible that you suggest that we must be born again? In fact, I think she actually asked that question. She had gone through a little Pentecostal bout. And, that's what I'm going to call it, Pentecostal bout. But it was with a very abusive pastor who taught her some very bad theology and used it to lord it over and control the people who were in the church. And so part of what I was doing was straightening out what she thought was true and what she thought was necessary to be a Christian. The other reason I called her Nicodemus by Day was because she came to me with an urgency. Like, she couldn't believe, but she knew in her heart of hearts that she had to believe. She didn't understand why she believed, and that scared her. Some of you might be in that same place. I've been in that place, where There is no good reason to believe in God. There is no good reason to believe the story of Jesus. There is no good reason to believe that the promises God made on the cross through Jesus are for me or are actually real. But I can't escape the sense of their truth. I can't escape knowing that somehow God works it out. And the scariest part is not knowing how. That's who my friend was. The scariest part was not knowing how. So I was being very honest with the kids today when I said, this part of scripture, it's like the longer you look at it, the less it makes sense. The more you read it, the more confusing it gets. You think that Jesus is actually making things clear for Nicodemus, but when I look at it, I say, how did that answer his question? I mean, really. Let's go back here for a second. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above, for the wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the spirit. What? Not helpful, Jesus. Not helpful at all. And the longer you wrestle with it, the more you realize that. The longer you live with it, the less it matters. Right? The part that matters after you've lived with it for a little while is not the how, it's the what. It's not the you must be baptized even, it's the when you're baptized. It's not the how often or how old you're baptized, it's the when you're baptized, you are given a second chance. You are given new life. You are breathed into yourself a whole new being. You were created by God once, but God never gives up on you. How many of you have a digital camera? How many of you have a camera on your phone? Okay, all right. How many of you remember taking pictures on film? How many of you remember how disappointing it was to get your film back and find out of the 24 or 36 exposures, you have 3 pictures that worked? And how expensive it was to find that out. And how long it took to find that out. Right? We're very blessed today. If I take a picture of you and it doesn't look good, we just take another one. If I take a picture that didn't work, I know instantaneously it didn't work, and I delete it, and I take a new one. Right?
Right.
Now that is the God of second chances. In some ways, God appreciates digital photography as much as we do. Because God wants to look at this world the way he imagined it when he created it. God wants to see your life the way he imagined it when he created you. We do a lot of things to blur image. We do a lot of things to mess up the lighting. sometimes when we take the picture, our finger gets in the way. God wants to create this world in His image. God created every one of us in His image. And it is through our baptism, it is through His second chances, that He gets to see that as a reality. Because we are viewed not through our own eyes, but through God's eyes. We are not judged by the world. We are judged by God. And this picture that He is painting, this picture that He is setting up, this portrait that He is trying to create, will not be complete. Maybe in our own lifetimes. But we are all a part of that image. We are all a part of that process. Because God is working in us through the waters of baptism, through the salvation of Jesus Christ. And that is where we find the beauty. Not in who we were yesterday, but in who God has promised we can be tomorrow. Amen?
Amen.
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 Good.
brothers and sisters, what is the second article of the Apostles' Creed?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
What is the meaning of the second article of the Apostles' Creed?
I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father from eternity, and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord. He has redeemed me, a lost and condemned creature, bought me and freed me from all sins, from death and the power of the devil. He has done this not with silver or gold, but with his holy and precious blood, and with his innocent suffering and death, in order that live under him in his kingdom, and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness. He has risen from the dead, and lives and reigns for all eternity. This is most certainly true.
With the whole church, let us pray. God, we thank you for this place that we can worship, for these people who you have drawn into community. We pray that you continue to speak your word to us, that we might be changed by you, so we might change the world for you. We pray, God, for travel mercies for our friend Jackie. And we pray also for Allie and Isaiah as they continue their time in St. Louis, that you continue to enrich them, bringing them back to us safely with the good news of your gospel and how to better proclaim it. We pray right now for Kathy's dad, Jim, as he is far away from home and not having the vacation he had planned. But we pray that you would be with the doctors and nurses, healing him and helping him to recover, that he might enjoy the rest of his time on his trip. We pray, God, for those who are grieving today, for the friends of Garnet's Folly, for the friends of Rose and Donnie, for Tim Totten and his family, and Vinny and his family. We pray that you would be ever near them, that you would be strengthening them, bringing them promise of your hope, the promise of the joy in your resurrection. God, we thank you for the many ways that you have blessed us, for the many ways that you have sustained us, and we pray that you will help us to be a blessing to others, that you will help us to look outside of ourselves, to show the world your love, to show the world your care, and to continue to serve the people who you love, who do not know yet about that love. All these things we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. At this time, we'll receive our offerings. Please be seated. remember that in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for remembrance of me." Again, after supper, Jesus took the cup, blessed it, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup, the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people, and the forgiveness of sin. Do this for remembrance of me."
Spirit.
to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the star and crown? Good Lord, show me the way. Oh, sinners, let's go down, let's go down, come on down. Oh, sinners, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown? Good Lord, show me the way.
May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
And as we're sent forth, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope in the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
It's a song.
make one announcement.